Okay, all right. Well, welcome to Physics 703, everybody. Again, as I said, if you want, you can turn your videos off now. But I would request about at least two or three of you keep your videos turned on for the duration of the class so that I can have some visual feedback. Okay? Otherwise, it feels like I'm talking. Otherwise, put yourself in my place. Imagine that you're giving a lecture. You cannot see anybody's face. Anna, what would that feel like? It would feel pretty strange, right? So, okay. So in the last lecture, we were talking about tunneling in quantum mechanics, right? And we set up the Schrodinger equation as always. And we have three different regions, right? Here, here, and here. The solution in region two and in all of these regions is easy, right? Because the potential is a constant in all three of those regions. It just takes different values. So what do you get? We get our three solutions. In region one, we have this solution where A, this represents the incoming part of the wave, and this represents the outgoing part of the wave. In region three, we have again two parts, but we remove the incoming part. We only keep the outgoing part. And in region two, what I had said incorrectly was that you have two solutions. One is an increasing exponential, one is a decreasing exponential. And what I had said was that, well, we should throw away this decreasing exponential because we expect the amplitude to decrease. And that was my mistake, because first of all, if you do this, if you throw this away, you will get a trivial solution. So we can see that, like, if you work out the boundary conditions and everything, we are left with this set of equations. And if you look at this set of equations, then, for instance, you can take these two expressions, right, for the boundary condition at x is equal to L. And you can divide both sides, left and right, you know, by the respective sides. And what you will get is an expression of this form, right? You'll get ik is equal to minus k prime. And this actually doesn't make any sense because we know, first of all, that k cannot be equal to k prime. And also because we know that k prime is more complex, right? Because of the way we have defined k prime, we have defined it like this. So it's the square root of a positive number. So it's a real number, it's not complex. So what we should do is we should keep this component also. The sum of both of these will ultimately give you a decreasing profile, right? So the coefficient D will be larger than the coefficient C, right? But we cannot throw this away in the beginning. So again, we work out the boundary condition exactly the same way as before. We have at x is equal to zero. These are the two equations that you get from the continuity and differentiability, and at x is equal to L from continuity and differentiability, right? So we want to solve. So how many equations do we have? We have four equations. And how many unknowns do we have? We have A, B, C, D, F, five unknowns. So it might seem that our system of equations is undetermined, but that is not the case. Because what we actually want to determine are the transmission and reflection probability. So the transmission probability is the ratio of the amplitude of the transmitted wave divided by the amplitude of the incoming wave, right? So it's F by A squared, amplitude squared, and the other one is B by A, amplitude squared. So since we want these ratios, we can get that by dividing everything by A. If you divide everything by A, so we are solving for B by A, C by A, D by A, and F by A, right? And so we are solving for four unknowns rather than for five unknowns. Okay, so we have four equations and four unknowns. So we are good. Now, if you solve these, right, you can solve this. It takes a bit of algebra. I'll give you. I'll work out some of it, not all of it, just to show you how to do it. I mean, it's all fairly simple. Hopefully high school level algebra, but you know, again. So what we want to do is we want to eliminate C and D, right? We want to eliminate these two. So let's solve for them first. And we will solve for C and D using these two equations. Then we can substitute that expression back in here. And then we can solve for A and B. Okay, so how do you solve for this? Well, you can take this K prime and put it here, right? And then you have these two expressions. You can just add and subtract them. If you add them, what will you get? You will get C E K prime L is equal to F E I K L times 1 plus I K. K prime, right? And if you subtract them, you will get D times e to the minus K prime L F E I K L by 2, 1 minus I K by K prime, right? And then what we want is we want C plus D and C minus D, right? So what will C plus D be? Let's look at it. We'll get F E I K L. This will all be common in all the terms. And I'll get E to the minus K prime L, right? This exponent will go over on one, the other side, divided by 2, 1 plus I K by K prime. This will go over on the other side. I'll get E to the K prime L by 2, 1 minus I K by K prime. Now this looks a little bit complicated, but if you notice, you have these two terms here, and you can take these terms together. When you combine these terms, what you will get is hyperbolic cosine and hyperbolic sine, right? So you will get e to the I K L cosine K prime L, right? And then the other term will be let's see, I K by K prime by 2 e to the minus K prime L like this, right? So what I can do is I can divide by I and multiply by I. So on top, I'll get a minus 1. And so this will be equal to pinch K prime L, right? So this will be F e to the I K L cosine K prime L. And so the minus sign I can take into the expression in the brackets here, and I will get pinch. So I'll get plus K by K prime pinch K prime like that, right? Similarly, when you take C minus D, what will happen? Well, pretty much the same thing, right? Only thing is that here you'll get a minus sign. So sinh and cosinh will be swapped, right? So you'll get F e to the I K L. This term will give you minus sinh K prime L. And the second term will give you I K by K prime by 2 minus, right? And what is this? This will just give you hyperbolic cosine minus sine h k prime l, and then plus I k by k prime. So we have C plus D and we have C minus D. And So we can solve this explicitly for both C and D, right? We can just add and subtract, and that gives us C. C is F e to the I k L by 2, right? And the sum of these expressions will get cos minus sinh, which will again give us some expressions. I'll leave that for you to figure out. Okay. And then let me quote the final answer, which was in which All right, so the final expression is something like this. Let me write it down. You will get F by A is equal to E to the I k L. Okay, so I hope that you all can see that it's not too difficult to work out all of this algebra, right? Plus cosine k prime L plus I, and then we'll need this quantity gamma. Gamma is some combination of k and k prime times sinh k prime L, and this k to k prime by k minus k by k prime. So this is F by A, and similarly you can get B by A. So this will give you the probability of transmission, right? So the probability of transmission is F by A squared, right? Now when you take F by A squared, what do you get? This term will cancel out, right? You'll be left with cosine K prime L squared plus gamma squared by 4 sin square k prime, right? Because multiplied by the complex conjugate, right? You get a plus ib times a minus ib, that gives you a square plus b square. So you get this. All right. So now this expression can be simplified, can be viewed in this way. So let's see, what is cosine k prime L e to the k prime L plus e to the minus k prime L by 2, right? So again, if you take the square and do all of this, so I'll leave that as a homework problem. Okay, evaluate. Dependence on L. Okay. So very roughly speaking, all right, this is not the exact solution. This is a very rough solution. It's an order of magnitude solution. Is the following, right? So if you don't want to solve the whole problem and you just want to get an idea of what the transmission probability is going to be, you can do it as follows. You have the state in these three regions. You have the amplitude for the incoming wave, the outgoing wave, and then in here, the amplitude decreases. And then here we have the outgoing wave, right? And actually, this is, when you draw it like this, it's slightly misleading the correct way to draw it would be like this. Like this. So it's not as if one wave is shifted downwards in some sense, right? Because they are all defined along the same real axis. It's just that the amplitude of one is reduced compared to the amplitude of the other. Again, not a terribly good drawing, but right. So if you want to make a very rough estimate, order of magnitude estimate of what this change in amplitude will be, we can just ask ourselves what happens in this region, right? In this region, we have seen that the state behaves like approximately like e to the minus k prime n, right? The decreasing part, we'll assume that the coefficient d, we'll assume that this coefficient d is going to dominate over c, all right? And so this is the part that will make the biggest difference, right? This has to be the case, because otherwise if c dominates, then you will get amplification of the wave, right? Which wouldn't make sense, I mean, physically, because you're sending something in through a barrier. On the other side, it should come out attenuated, meaning it should be reduced in intensity, right? It should not come out with more intensity than you sent it, right? So if you want to do a rough order of magnitude estimate of f by a, the amplitude of f by a, the ratio of these amplitudes will be of the order this exponent minus k prime n. And so the probability of transmission will be of the order minus 2 k prime. Okay. Now, so this is what quantum mechanics is telling us, right? Quantum mechanics is telling us that even though I have a system in which, according to classical mechanics, right? So in classical mechanics, if I have a particle whose energy is less than the height of this potential, then that particle cannot cross over the barrier, right? There is a turning point, right? There is a classical turning point. So the trajectory of the particle has to turn back, right? But what quantum mechanics is telling us is that even if there is a barrier and the energy of your incoming excitation is less than the energy of your barrier, there is a probability, a non-zero probability, that your particle can tunnel from one side to the other. Okay? And the probability depends on two factors. It depends on k prime and it depends on L. Right? So what is L? L is the width of the barrier. So as the barrier width increases, you would expect that the probability of tunneling should decrease, right? And that is, well, what we have in this order of magnitude estimate. What is k prime? K prime is root 2 m v naught minus e by h bar square. So this is a measure of how much greater than e is v naught, right? So if my barrier height is this much, and my energy of the particle is over here, this particle should have a lower probability of going through than a particle which has more energy, right? But still less than the height of the potential. So this k prime, it has this coefficient v naught minus e, right? It measures this difference between the two energies. So again, as k prime increases, that means my barrier is height is more than my energy. So my probability of tunneling should decrease, right? So I have both of those expectations shown in this expression. Okay. Now, one might ask, well, This is all very nice and wonderful, but is there any actual use for this, right? And it turns out that there is a phenomenon that is known as beta decay, right? So what is beta decay? Can somebody tell me what is beta decay? No? Okay. So beta decay, are you guys still with me? Are we still connected? Can somebody say something? This is why I asked you to keep your videos turned on.
Yes, sir.
So beta decay is a process in which you have a neutron. A neutron decays into a proton plus an electron. And then the excess kinetic energy is released. So there's some binding energy that is released in the form of the kinetic energy of these particles and also in the form of a gamma ray photon. And so this beta decay, right? There are different kinds of radioactive processes. This is called beta decay, and this mediates. So, for instance, if you start with some element and it has some atomic number, okay. So, let me write like this. An atomic weight and atomic number. What's the notation again? I forget. Let me just make something up. Okay. So this is the atomic number and this is the atomic weight. All right. So what happens due to beta decay in the nucleus? In the nucleus, the atomic number is a measure of the number of protons. The atomic number increases by one. Right? Because one neutron is replaced by one proton. So the number of protons increases by one. What about the atomic weight? The atomic weight doesn't change, right? I mean, there is a small change in the atomic weight due to the loss of this, due to the energy that is carried away by the reaction products, right? So this becomes some other element. Which has atomic number one higher and the same atomic number. Okay, so this is called beta decay. Now the question is, how can this be? How classically is this possible? Okay, so classically, what you have is you have some nucleus, right? It is filled with protons. And it is and neutrons, right? So these are your neutrons. For some reason, it seems to me that a neutron would be yellow and a proton would be blue. Of course, this is just my aesthetic preference. You are free to choose differently, right? And then what happens in the process of beta decay? In the process of beta decay, one of these protons let's say this one changes into a proton sorry one of these neutrons changes into a proton plus an electron. Okay. And for some reason, electrons should be green. Okay. And then there is a gamma ray, which is emitted. Right. So there's no problem in the gamma ray being emitted. But now if you look at this system from a classical perspective, right? So this here you start out with atomic number Z, right? Whatever Z is, could be 80, 90, 60. And here you end up with atomic number Z plus one, right? You have one extra proton. So you have Z plus one protons plus one electron, right? Now, this process of beta decay means that this electron should also be able to exit, right? It should be able to leave the nucleus. But if you look at this situation, there is an attractive Coulomb potential, right? There is a Coulomb potential, which looks like this. Minus K Z plus one E square divided by R square, R naught square, where we'll take R naught to be approximately, let's say, one femtometer. That's the typical order of magnitude of a nucleus, size of a nucleus, right? So if you look at this potential energy is very, very large. Okay, this potential energy is of the order of MeV, right? But the electron which is emitted in beta decay, right? You can measure this emitted electron. It doesn't have that much energy, right? And also you can just do a simple estimate that if you look at the rest mass of a neutron and the rest mass and you talk ask how much kinetic energy will the emitted electron have, it is going to be much less than the height of this potential, right? So what you have is that you have a electron that is sitting behind this potential, right? It has some energy E, but that energy is much less than the height of this potential, right? Or if you want to be more accurate about it, you can draw the Coulomb potential like this. Let's say this is R, this is V of R. What does a Coulomb potential look like? Looks like this, right? It's an attractive potential. And what is the energy of our electron? And our electron is sitting somewhere over here, right? So how does the electron manage to tunnel out of this potential, right? Because a classical particle cannot escape, right? If it has this much energy, it cannot escape. It needs to have some positive amount of energy, right? It needs to get some energy which delta E, which makes its energy higher than the Coulomb potential, right? Higher than this level, which is zero in this. So what happens is tunneling, right? So the electron tunnels out of the nucleus. Okay, and so if there was no quantum mechanics, you would not have beta decay. So no QM means no beta decay. And we obviously know that that is not true because, well, we do observe beta decay. Okay. All right, so this is it for tunneling. I'm going to leave it here. Are there any questions about this? Okay. All right, then. So let's look at what else is left for us to do. Let's look at the remaining topics. We need to talk about angular momentum. And then, well, other topics. Remaining topics include composite systems, entanglement, and bosons and fermions, etc. Bosons and fermions. And then I would like to work out a simple problem of a Hamiltonian of spin 1/2 particle in a magnetic field. Okay, so these are the remaining topics, right? So before I begin on one of these, let me ask again, are there any questions about tunneling? Are there any questions about finite potential well, and so on and so forth, or any questions about anything related to the class, except for your corrections, which I'm doing. I don't know, very, very overdue.
Sir?
Yes.
The force, actually the potential graph inside the nucleus is also repulsive in nature.
Who is this? Sorry,
like there is Ashutosh. Certain.
Yes, Ashutosh, which one? Sorry.
Sir, the potential graph inside the nucleus is repulsive in nature also. Like you call potential. So what exactly is happening?
No, so this is not the potential between the electron and the protons is not going to be the Yukawa potential. No? The Yukawa potential is between protons and neutrons. Okay, we're talking about the force between protons and electrons. All right. That's not given by that's not, yeah, I mean it's good that you're reading all these things and all, but
sorry, sir, network issue.
Yeah, go ahead.
I did not hear you.
You didn't hear me. Okay. So we are talking about the potential between protons and electrons, right?
Yes, sir.
Is that potential given by the Yukawa term?
No exact idea about the derivation. No exact idea about the derivation behind Yukawa potential. I just
then just don't say random things if you don't have the exact idea.
There is a question in a book where there is a Yukawa potential and there is an explanation of radioactivity of beta decay. So I did not able to understand what.
So can you like share that like book or reference with me so that I can look at this problem and then I can give you a better answer.
Okay. Huh?
But yes, what you are referring to the Yukawa potential. The Yukawa force, so that is mediated by particles known as pions, and that force exists between protons and neutrons, and between protons and neutrons, and protons and protons and between neutrons and neutrons, and it is distinct from the Coulomb force. The Coulomb force acts between protons and electrons, and between protons and protons, and between electrons. But they are very distinct from each other. When the electron is, and the electron does not feel the Yukawa force, as far as I understand. But again, in field theory, one always has higher and higher order terms, so there can be some contribution from the Yukawa force. But the main contribution, I believe, it comes from the Coulomb potential of the protons. Did you catch all that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Anything else? First of all, if you're going to ask me a question, at least turn your video on so I can see your face. I have no idea where you are, right? I can't see you. I don't know whether you can understand me, whether you can hear me. Ashutosh, can you please turn your video on?
Yes, sir. Sure. Yes.
Where is it? कहाँ पे आपका video है Ashutosh? आपने on किया है क्या? अच्छा. एक सेकेंड. देखने दीजिए. Okay, now say something, because if you say something now, the video should come up in the gallery view. Otherwise, it doesn't reach to the top. So, did you understand what I'm trying to tell you?
Yes, sir. Coulombic potential, I have understood, but the question regarding your power potential, there is a repulsive potential nature.
Can you share that with me? Can you share that reference with us?
Yes, sir. Right now?
Well, you can share it right now if you want. In the meantime, I can answer some other questions.
Sir, I will come to you and your office.
As you wish.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay. Any other questions? Amrish, did you have a question? I think Amrish, you were unmuted for a while. Did you want to ask?
No, sir. No, sir. Actually, okay. The Wi-Fi is very unstable here in campus.
Yeah. What to do? Okay. So the next topic that I want to talk about is going to be angular momentum, and I think I'll start that topic. In our next class, okay? Because I won't be able to cover it in properly in the remaining time in today's class. Okay. Preetam, you have any questions?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Right. Okay, then I will see you all on Tuesday morning, and I will also tell you the time for the next second quiz on Tuesday. I think most likely I will have it on the coming Monday, 1 week from now. Okay. All right. Okay, so I'll see you all on Wednesday. Sorry, Wednesday. Okay, bye bye.
Thank you, sir.
If anybody has any questions, they are welcome to ask. Otherwise, I'll see you all on Wednesday.
Sir, I just had one question.
Yeah, go ahead, Deshika.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, so this phenomenon of quantum tunneling, like, do we see it in the photoelectric effect? Because that also has threshold frequency.
Yes. So there also what you have is. You have these electrons, and they are bound to the surface of the metal.
Yeah.
By the Coulomb, attractive Coulomb force of the the nucleon, right? The protons in the on the latter. And so there is a binding force there, of course. But there, in that case, we are actually sending in an external particle, right? We are supplying energy to the electron.
Right. Yeah.
We're supplying energy to the electron from an external source.
Okay.
Right. And so what we are doing is we are manually pushing the electron from the lower energy level to the higher energy level.
Okay. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So in that case, so tunneling is a process in this beta decay picture. It is something that happens spontaneously. You have a system and it spontaneously decays to a lower energy state.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, got it. So so that means if the electron is not at that threshold frequency in photoelectric effect, there's no chance of it to be ejected out. There's no quantum tunneling possible there.
No, there could be.
Okay.
There could be, but then there needs to be some mechanism to give the electron a large enough kick to send it away from the nucleus also.
Oh.
Right. So in this case, when you have this neutron which decays.
Right.
Right. So the proton is lighter than the neutron, right?
Hmm.
And so there is some binding energy of these constituents. That binding energy is converted into the kinetic energy of the individual particle. That's the energy of this photon, right? So this electron is given some, it starts out with some kinetic energy. It gets a kick.
Okay.
Right.
And
then in the process of tunneling, it loses some of that energy.
Right? Okay.
But it has enough energy to escape the potential.
Okay, got it. Hmm? But so what about? I'll say. So, what about the photon giving a kick in to the electron and photoelectric effect? Wouldn't that work?
If you don't need to use an explanation to describe a certain phenomenon, right?
Right.
Then we cannot we shouldn't force it upon that. Right?
Yeah. Okay.
So in this case, everything is perfectly well described by. So for instance, if you have ionization. Right, the process of ionization, you would not say that is tunneling because again you have a some electron in a bound state and it is excited to a free state by some external source.
Yeah.
Right. So there is no need to, again, there is no need to invoke tunneling to explain that.
Okay, got it.
Right. Now if there was something from the experimental side, some indication that there is, some spontaneous ionization is happening in the vacuum or something like that, right? Some weird process like that. Then one would, look for some explanation involving tunneling, maybe.
Yeah, got it. Okay. Yeah, yes, sir.
So just to give you a simplified picture of this, you can think of a particle which is in a one-dimensional potential, which looks like this, right? So
yes.
These barriers have finite height and finite width.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So you have this particle. It has some energy, and it is bouncing around. Right.
Yeah.
But there
yes,
is
sir.
A finite probability that it could tunnel through and escape.
Yeah.
Right. So if you go back to the solution of a finite potential well, right? So here what we say is that you have this region of low energy, and then here this is the region of high energy, right?
Right. Yeah.
But then you could have some, you know, the again some region of low energy. And then what is the form of the solution in this region? It's not zero, right? It's a decaying exponential.
Yeah.
So if the region has a finite thickness, again the particle has a chance to come out on the other end.
Right, right. Yeah. Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? Okay, then I will stop the recording. Okay.